In this video, I want to go over the networking behind the Welch Allyn spot monitors and how to get them connected to a network. This monitor is fresh out of the box, hasn't been used, doesn't have a thermometer or the SpO2 sensor connected, so it's going to keep complaining that it doesn't have those things, but we don't really need them for this video for this purpose right now. So to get this networked, first of all, you need to have a valid network connection. In this case, I'm using my own home network for this, but it should still work okay. I'm just going to plug it into the bottom here where the Ethernet port is. And on the unit itself, I'm going to go to, let's see if I can make this a little bit more visible. There we go. So I'm going to go to settings. I'm going to go to advanced. I'm going to enter in the advanced settings code. Once you enter that in, press OK. And it'll take you into the advanced settings. So from here, I want to go to network, and I'm going to go to device IP. So right now it's using DHCP, but it's not receiving, it hasn't received a valid IP address yet. So instead, what we could do is we could set a static IP address. And in this case, I'm going to set it to 1 that hasn't been used. So that's an address on my network. I'll set the gateway to match that. Oops. .16.10.1, which is the router. And DNS, I also have my own internal DNS, so I'm just gonna do 1. Once you hit apply, even though it doesn't really look like it, it's changed its IP address internally. So if you go to service, you can see here, it's changed its current network information to match what we entered in the last page over. And you can see here also, it's actually done some, it's passed some network traffic to and from a device on the network, probably the router. It may also be reaching out to the internet, maybe look for an update or something like that. But you can verify that it saved it. What I can do is I can, I'll turn this off, power down, and I will, once it shuts down, I'll restart it and I'll come back to this when it's come back up. Okay, so now that it's done rebooting, we can verify that it saved the network information. We don't have to use the administrator or the privileged access code either. We can just go into settings, and up here we can go into advanced. Over here is our IP address that we set. But as an alternative, like in the previous videos, we can also use DHCP. There is a DHCP server on this network, so I don't have to necessarily enter in this information. I can just go back up here, select use DHCP, and then press apply. And then go back to service, and I can see here it's giving me a different IP address now, one that's been dynamically assigned, and it's also given the gateway and the DHCP address, and it's also sending some traffic on its new address as well. So now that I showed you the Ethernet way of connecting this, not including any kind of security protocols that may be in place, I will show you also the Wi-Fi version of this. And with Wi-Fi, it's a bit more tricky. So for this, I will put this aside for right now, go to a whiteboard and try and explain a little bit about Wi-Fi and why it's a bit more complicated to deal with than Ethernet. So Wi-Fi routers like this one are generally made up of several different devices. This is actually a router, a switch, and a wireless access point all put into one unit. And this is very common for domestic routers like this one. And generally on a network, they look something like this. So you have your router right here. Your router is going out to the internet somewhere, and you have an antenna, which is broadcasting the Wi-Fi network. And then you have your devices on the network that are also talking on the same Wi-Fi network to the and back to and from the router. With every Wi-Fi network, there is going to be a network name. And in this case, that's what we want to enter in on the Welch Allyn. The Welch Allyn is not going to be able to detect wireless access points automatically. It doesn't show you a listing. Like if you had your phone and you're trying to connect to Wi-Fi, it would show you a list of all the different networks. That doesn't do that, or this doesn't do that. What you'd have to do instead is enter in what's called the ESSID, which essentially is the network name that this router is putting out. Wi-Fi can take many different forms. With a home unit like this one, the process that a device uses to connect to it is pretty simple. Let's say I have my, let's just say it's a spot monitor. It could be a phone, it could be a computer. It's really the same process either way. You enter in the network name and then you enter in the password. And then from there, the device is able to communicate directly with this router, sending the password in an encoded form, and the router will check that to make sure it's correct, and then it's able to join the network without ever leaving this little bubble here. And from there, it's able to connect to your Wi-Fi router. Where this stops working, though, is with any kind of managed Wi-Fi network or just a managed network in general, which is very common in businesses and enterprise environments. SPC, for example, has a more managed Wi-Fi system. So what they have instead is they have their Wi-Fi access points, which are not routers. They're actually just the one part of this machine. Attached to that, they usually go off to a switch somewhere, and then from there to a router, which then routes it to the internet or to other parts of the network. When you want to connect a device to this, though, it gets more complicated. Because the way it's usually set up, say again, this is a phone or, you know, a spot monitor, a computer, whatever, and you want to join, let's just say this is SPC's network. So when you want to join this network, you have to enter in usually your student ID and your password, and that's being sent up to the access point. But the access point's not the one that's actually doing the authentication, like in your domestic setting, where all that magic is happening outside of this box. What this does instead is it takes those credentials, moves it up through the access point into the switch, and through whatever path it may be set up, it will go to another server in SPC's network. And this server is specifically there for user authentication. And it could be even more complicated than that. If in certain networking setups, they may have an additional server, which is a certificate server, which is there to ensure that your device is sending the password along with the correct certificate for the authentication machine. And that's where it starts. It sounds really complicated, and it really is complicated. It can get very complicated very quickly, especially in SPC's case, because they have what they want to do. Like a lot of large businesses, they have what's called SSO, which stands for single sign-on. And what that does is essentially it lets you use a single username and password for basically everything. If you want to connect to their network, you use your student ID and your password. If you want to log into SPC's website, student ID, password. If you want to, usually if you have a computer in the library or whatever, you're logging into that with your student ID and your password. So all of these devices on the network and all these computers are all using the same set of credentials, and that can't all be stored in one access point like it would be in your home setting. That's why they have dedicated systems just for user management, authentication, certificate management. All that stuff has to interconnect with each other in order for your device to connect to SPC's network. So if that sounded really complicated, don't worry, because it is, and it only gets more complicated as you go on. So the main takeaway from that, though, is there's a lot of setup involved with certain types of networking. So for here, for example, your standard home router would use WPA2 personal. So there's just normally a passphrase, and that's all it really needs. It's just going to talk directly to this home router, and that's how it's going to authenticate. If you're trying to connect it to SPC's network, for example, you would use WPA2 Enterprise. And there you have your username and password like you would have if you were logging into their Wi-Fi or something like that. But you also have to configure the type of authentication and security that's in place, whether that's PBMS-CHAP or more likely PTLS, or it just depends on the network. You may also have to enable server authentication, and like I said, there's a lot of interconnected systems with this that make it very difficult to connect this particular unit to SPC's network without having more set up in advance. So what I'm going to do instead is connect it to my simple little home router here, which I already know the network name of. So I'll click on there, and I will erase the default name for whatever that particular name is for, and enter in the network name of that router over there. So I've entered in the network name for this, which I just named BMET test. That matches the network name on the router. Click OK. And you want to click Update Radio. And click OK for that. And it's going to try and associate with the wireless access point over here. I can go over to Service and Radio Stats. And you can see here it's waiting to associate with that network. So you can see right here, it is connected to this home router right here. It does have a valid DHCP address, so if I go back to here, under, or just right here actually, you can see it has a unique name or IP address that was given to it via DHCP. So to recap, once you get into the system settings, I'm gonna go to Network, Radio, change the ESS ID to match whatever network name you're trying to connect to. Security is the next step you want to do. You want to go and choose your authentication type. In this example, there's no password on this or encryption, but generally you would want to select the matching type of encryption and enter in the password and stuff for that. Each time you change something, you want to click Update Radio, though, because if you change the next page, it will erase the settings on the previous page if you hadn't pressed Update Radio. Otherwise, to set a static IP address in the Networking tab, go to Device IP, and then you can choose between either DHCP or you can set a static IP address.